Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. Edward for our celebration of the third Sunday of Easter. Today is also the Knights of Columbus Corporate Communion Weekend. Please take a moment to acknowledge our fellow parishioners and knights here today and streaming online. You can do that by waving and a nice smile underneath your mask. Before we begin, we please ask you to silence your cell phones. Thank you. Our presider for today is Father Rick. Please join us in singing our gathering song found in your worship aid. Sing a new song.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we gather on this third Sunday of the Easter season, we first take a moment to pause and reflect on those times that we've sinned so that we might prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus, you call all to yourself and promise peace to those who follow your commandments. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you bid us to seek forgiveness of our sins and reconciliation to you. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are our Savior. You are our risen Redeemer. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
We adore you.
May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter said to the people, "The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied in Pilate's presence when he had decided to release him. You denied the Holy and Righteous One and asked that a murderer be released to you. The author of life you put to death, but God raised him from the dead, and to this we are witnesses. Now I know, brothers, that you acted out of ignorance, just as your leaders did. But God has thus brought to fulfillment what he had announced beforehand, through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be wiped away." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of St. John. My children, I am writing this to you so that you may not commit sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is expiated for our sin, and not for our sin only, but for those of the whole world, that we may be sure that we know him, is to keep his commandments. Those who say, I know him, but do not keep his commandments, are liars, and the truth is not in them. But whoever keeps his word, the love of God is truly perfected in him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Disciples recounted what had taken place on the way and how Jesus was made known to them in the breaking of bread. While they were still speaking about this, he stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." But they were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. Then he said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do questions arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, because a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you can see I have." And he said to them, he showed them that his hands and his feet. While they were still incredulous for joy and were amazed, he asked them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of baked fish. He took it and ate it in front of them. He said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and in the prophets and Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning.
Good morning, Father.
Hard to believe, as beautiful and sunshiny as this morning is, I think they're predicting some snow for this coming week. So don't put away those shovels just yet. Okay. Everybody likes old expressions, right? Especially old people. We've been living with them for quite a while. The proof is in the pudding. Does anybody still use that today? The proof is in the pudding. I'm looking at an old guy and he's telling me no. They still use it. I heard on a commercial the other day, or maybe it was a TV show, where a recent TV show where it came across, the proof is in the pudding. What exactly does that mean when we hear that? To put it simply, it's in the pudding where what is claimed to be true is tested. It's where we look for evidence of what supports a particular claim that is being made. It's where we look for results. Where's the results? Where's the proof? We believe, as we gather together this Sunday and every Sunday, as Christians, we believe in a fundamental tenet of our faith. We believe in the bodily resurrection of Jesus Christ. If we didn't believe that that happened, there would be no church and we would not be here. But what's the proof in the pudding in regard to that? When it comes to something, think about it. When it comes to something that is so utterly unheard of, resurrection, and so completely at odds with human logic, the burden of proof is on the one who claims it. It's put on the one who claims it. If the proof is in the pudding, then what was in the pudding of the resurrection of Jesus? For Jesus, it was simply this, a body. A real body, transformed by the resurrection, we know, glorified through the resurrection, but a real body nonetheless. The gospel message this week and last week drive that point home, like a 100-pound sledgehammer. Last week in John's gospel, Jesus told Thomas what? To put his fingers into the nail marks in his hands and to put his hand into his side. This was no ghost. This was no mass delusion or hallucination on the part of the apostles. The resurrected body of Jesus Christ was real. In this week's gospel that we just heard proclaimed from Luke, Jesus tells his apostles, "Touch me, feel my flesh and bones." Again, this body is not a ghost. You're not dreaming this. It's not a hallucination. This body is so real that it even experiences hunger. Do you have anything to eat? Jesus asks them. The resurrected Jesus as a real, physical, biologically functioning body was witnessed, we know, by the apostles on a number of occasions. Not just in Jerusalem, but remember he goes up to Galilee, and the first time he sees them, he's on the shore next to the charcoal fire while they're out fishing. We heard about that in the scripture readings not too long ago. And he was also witnessed, his resurrection, his resurrected body was also witnessed, we're told in the scriptures, by hundreds of others. Doesn't specify who they are. It just says that hundreds of others witnessed his resurrected body as well. So for Jesus, the proof that was in the pudding was the body. Was his body, a real body, once dead, but now resurrected. So then, what about the apostles? What about those who first saw the body of Jesus resurrected? What was the proof in the pudding that showed that they did see and actually and truly believed? It was their complete transformation. Their complete transformation. Think about it. There were 11 of them at that time. Judas is out of the picture and not yet replaced. 11 frightened, cowering men who saved one of them, just one, the Apostle John, fled from the scene of the crucifixion, and even whose leader denied Jesus three times. They were completely transformed. Think about it. If Jesus hadn't risen from the dead, if it was all just a lie, if they were all just making it up, would that conspiracy to perpetuate a lie have transformed them in the way that it did, from terrified cowards into bold proclaimers of this resurrected Jesus, and doing it at the risk of their very lives? Could that have taken place if only to perpetuate a lie, a falsehood? Agreeing to spread a lie doesn't produce that kind of transformation from fear to courage. It could only have resulted from them having experienced the risen Lord in their presence and receiving the gift of his Spirit. For the apostles, the proof that was in their pudding was the amazing transformation. Now, we might ask, because we acknowledge that there are other world religions that exist, what about those other world religions? They've spread, too, over the centuries, and they have. It's true. But think about it. Think about it. None of them started with such a small, really, ragtag group that was up against such huge odds. And more importantly, none of them made the amazing and even outrageous claims about their leader that those first Christians made about Jesus. They proclaimed something unthinkable, that God had become a man, that he had sacrificed himself, died and rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven. By all logical reason, Christianity should have been squashed by either the Romans, who had their own pagan gods and didn't need some other thing going on, or by the Jewish religious leaders, who at that time did not have an understanding of what had happened. It should have been squashed before it had a chance to get off the ground. Other Jewish messianic movements, movements of a Messiah, already had. But not the Jesus movement. Not the Jesus movement. It overcame every odd. So where does that leave us today? We're here today. Where does it leave us, who are a very important part of this story? What's the proof of Jesus' resurrection that's in our pudding? How do we witness to our belief in the resurrection of Christ from the dead? We do it this way. We do it by proclaiming that while we know the resurrected Christ has ascended into heaven, is now seated at the right hand of the Father, on earth, his Spirit lives. It lives on in us and through us, not symbolically or metaphorically, but really and truly. Just to give you an example, we could say the Spirit of Abraham Lincoln lives on in all of us who continue to fight against racial injustice and inequality. And there's a way of thinking about that, that it's true. The Spirit of Lincoln lives on in us. But it's not nearly the same way we talk about when we talk about the Spirit of the Lord living on in us. Because what are all of us gathered here today, this morning? We are temples of that Holy Spirit. Lincoln's Spirit doesn't literally reside in us. Maybe his Spirit that kind of unites us in a certain cause, but the Spirit of God literally resides within us. And we know his Spirit lives in us when we speak the truth in the face of lies. We know his Spirit lives on in us when we stand up for those who are oppressed and cannot defend themselves. We know his Spirit is alive in us when we show compassion for those suffering or who are in pain. We know his Spirit is alive within us when we bring love and mercy, healing and forgiveness to wherever and to whomever it is needed. That's the proof that's in our pudding. That's our proof that Jesus rose from the dead and sent his Spirit to live in us. That in his church today, the church on earth, which is the mystical body of Christ, he lives on and his mission continues. And we know that it could not continue if he was not present with us and within us. It wouldn't work. It would collapse. It would fall. Today, brothers and sisters, every year we have a kickoff for the Catholic Services Appeal. That's a way that we can participate communally in helping to carry on that mission of our Lord in our diocese and in other parts of the world. I just wanted to review with you quickly, because we do go through this every year, so we're familiar with this. Through the 66 parishes of the diocese, The goal this year is to raise for five key areas involved with evangelization, ministry, and outreach, about $2.25 million, which was raised last year, even through COVID. Of that total, our parish goal is $35,589, so a little bit over $35,000. Just again, a key to remind you of where this money goes and why we do this every year. 25% of those CSA funds, which means basically $1 out of every $4, or a quarter out of every dollar that we donate, goes to the education and formation of seminarians, our future priests, our future pastors, and also helps to provide for our retired priests and religious in their latter years. 22%, which is almost, again, almost a quarter out of every dollar, goes to charitable outreach to those in need through organizations like Catholic Charities locally, as well as to global ministries in other parts of the world. About a third goes to Catholic education, helping to pay tuition assistance and services for our parish grade schools and diocesan high schools. Even though we don't have a school here anymore, it's very important, a very important part of the life of the diocese. 14% of these funds go to ministry and formation programs in the diocese, including helping to form our catechists, our teachers of the faith, lay ecclesial ministry, which a number of our parishioners have gone through that program. And we know two in particular in our parish who have gone through the diaconate formation program as well. These are things which not everyone participates in, but through those who do, helps our parishes, which are alive and active, to be even more vibrant and active in the community. And lastly, 7% in this era of advancing technology and all these different ways to communicate, 7% of the funds go to communication and evangelization efforts through print media, live streaming, webcasts, podcasts, and other forms of social media. We've seen how important that is in this last year to year and a half with the COVID situation. I don't have cards in the pews. In the vestibule, there are about four or five different areas set up with pledge envelopes and cards inside. I just ask that you take a card home, even if you're not considering at this moment in time, perhaps being able to pledge, but to take a card and an envelope home and to pray about it and to see how you can help us in this aspect of carrying on the ministry of Christ in our diocese and in the world. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. As we carry on the mission of Jesus Christ in his church today through the presence of the Holy Spirit within us, we lift up our prayers and petitions to our God and Father.
that our church may boldly proclaim the gospel to all the ends of the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the tireless efforts of all Christ's faithful may bear fruit in unity, peace, and love among all men and women. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who are sick and those who are troubled may find the peace of heart offered by Christ to his disciples. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the members of the Knights of Columbus in our local council and throughout the world may continue the work of discipleship through charity, fellowship, living lives of faithfulness. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our young people receiving the sacrament of confirmation this Tuesday may be nurtured and guided by the Spirit throughout their lives. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Teresa Bell and all who have died may share a place at the heavenly banquet. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Joe Blanford, whom we remember in a special way at this liturgy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, hear the prayers your children humbly offer to you this day, and answer them according to your holy and perfect will. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exalted church, and as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. In Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He never ceases to offer himself for us, but defends us and ever pleads our cause before you. He is the sacrificial victim who dies no more, the Lamb once slain who lives forever. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Celebrate the memorial of the saving passion. the wondrous resurrection from the dead, and the ascension into heaven, of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven. And as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Edward and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis our Pope and Robert our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer one another the sign of peace.
Jesus.
Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Come, share the supper of the Lord.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray, find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all to him my own. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus,
defend us in battle, be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who prowl about the world for the ruin of souls. Amen. And our vocation prayer. God, our Father, you made each of us to use our gifts in the body of Christ. We ask that you inspire young people whom you call to the priesthood and consecrated life to courageously follow your will. Send workers into your great harvest so that the gospel is preached, the poor are served with love, the suffering are comforted, and your people are strengthened by the sacraments. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you were pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a few announcements this morning. Again, the CSA pledge envelopes are available in the vestibule, about four different locations. You'll see the little plastic containers that hold the envelopes. Also, TOTUS TUIS flyers are in the vestibule. This was something, a summer program, a week-long summer program for both our elementary and high school age kids that we did in 2019. We were not able to do it last year because of COVID. But those who participated the year before were very excited about the program and very complimentary and were wanting to see it come back. So we'll be doing that this summer, the week of
18th, maybe?
One of those weeks coming up. That's why you take home, there's two different flyers, take home two if you don't need. One's for, I think, volunteers, the other is to register a child or grandchild. If you don't if you take them all and there's none left, Bill will be happy to chop down a tree and make some more copies. The middle school youth group will be meeting this afternoon, Sunday, 1 to 3 in the gym. So our middle schoolers, we invite you to attend that. The CFF word of the day is witness. We talked about witnessing to the resurrection in so many different ways. And lastly, this is a part of the corporate communion for our Knights of Columbus this weekend. They're gathered not at one mass because of the COVID restrictions, but spread out at the different masses this weekend. Young men in the church, 30s, 40s, 50s, 20s, you do not have to be a senior citizen to join the Knights of Columbus. It may look that way, but we do have many young men in the Knights. Very active. There's so many different things they're involved with locally, statewide, nationally, internationally. Just a wonderful men's Catholic fraternal organization. I put a little blurb in the bulletin, thanks to the Knights and all of their helpers and all of you and all of our friends in the community who came out for all of the drive-through fish fries that we had this Lent. The Knights were able to donate to the parish $8,000. So that, yes. That is going directly into our savings account. I'm trying to build up the savings account as best as I can with the hope of in the next couple of years doing some work with our vestibule. The church, I think, is looking wonderful. It's been upgraded in many different ways, from the sound system to all of the different interior upgrades. We're going to be painting the church in early to mid-May to finish off the inside, but we still need to do work in the vestibule. So hopefully within the next couple of years, we can get something underway in that regard with your prayers and your help. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.